Okay, great. Thanks. Thanks. It's good to be back. We were here. Bill, you've been hiding in this row this whole time. We were here. Was it around March of this year? So I can give you an update of how life has been. My wife and I have enjoyed one of the most amazing years, and she's here tonight in the back of the room. So everybody, give Trina a big hand. We've gone through a campaign, and then she gets to put up with my flying up on Monday morning and back on Thursday evening, and it's just been a real treat. So, just for those, as Tom was saying, I was with Balzer Horowitz Frank and Wakeling, an accountancy corporation for 18 years, and I was 10 years as a partner and was the administrative partner when I left. It's now merged with Ronald Blue and Company, and some of you may know him as an author, Ron Blue. Then I was treasurer, tax collector, and we restored the department. And just before I was installed as supervisor, after I was elected, we negotiated a 71% reduction of the unfunded actuarial accrued liability for the retiree medical with the bargaining units. We were able to take it from $1.4 billion down to $425 million. We were able to reduce the annual required payment from $131 million a year to $31 million a year. So we've saved the taxpayers $100 million a year. So what we lost in the bankruptcy, $1.7 billion, I've kind of restored in just those that one move. And so, yeah, give me applause. That's good. Great. Thank you. And so then when I became supervisor in June of 06, the unrestricted net deficit on the financial statements was $30 million. The county was upside down, $30 million, which is what happens when you lose $1.7 billion. You lose all your retained earnings, right? But having fun and holding firm with all the bargaining units, when I left June of 2014, we were a positive $331 million. So we're doing a lot better. And so now I'm a state senator. Thank you very much for all your help and your votes and encouragement. And hoping that that will go through, what's that? 2028. I mean, it's a goal, you know, the power of a written goal, right? So I'm like one of the first that is able to stay for 12 years, but because I was elected midterm, I actually can stay 14 years, which really is a lot of leverage up there, because now they got to pay attention, because I should, you know, if I do everything right, get reelected, and then have a little more gravitas up there to get something done. Because what you find is when you get up there, you know, that you arrive before, you were there only 6 years, and so the bureaucracy just ignored you. They didn't care about the legislature. They just kind of do their own thing. We call it the B team. They were there before you got there. They're there while you're there, and they'll be there when you're gone, right? It's just one of those things. So we're going to have some fun up there shaking it up. We have 40 members in the state Senate, so we have 38 million in the state. So about each of us have about a million constituents. I'm the only one, it came up today in a question, but I'm the only one in Orange County that is strictly in Orange County. Senator Bates has a little bit of San Diego. Senator Wynn has a little bit of L.A. I'm on the Judiciary Committee, kind of give you an update of all the fun I'm having. I am not a lawyer. Don't ask me how I got appointed to this. I don't know if it's like for being good or for being bad. I haven't figured it out, but they made me vice chair, and it's a real interesting opportunity. I'm also on Governance and Finance, and we met and had a hearing yesterday. In L.A., Senator Bob Hertzberg is the chairman of that committee. He was former Speaker of the Assembly. He's now back, and we're working together. He and I were the only two that showed up for this committee meeting. It got an article in today's Register. The state has this nice program that when you prepare your tax return, you can give money to one of the 13 or 14 selected charities on page 4 of the 540. And then the state will, theoretically, transfer that money to the nonprofits. And so an AP reporter figured out they weren't really getting the money over to the nonprofits. So I had a fun day. got some great quotes, too. But anyway, kind of had a chance to take our state controller to task, because she just did an audit report last month on how the State Board of Equalization wasn't really managing their money right. You know, and you gotta be really careful what you say about people, because it can kind of flip and come right back at you. So It's real interesting. But it's a great committee. I've had a lot of fun in this committee, and I'll explain that some more later. I'm also on budget, which is perfect. Budget is sort of chopped up into subcommittees, so we might have a full budget committee once in a while, but we also meet regularly for our subcommittees. And Subcommittee 1 oversees the education program for the state. You know, it's 40% of our budget, K through 12, community colleges, the UC system, the CSU system. So I get to debate with people like Janet Napolitano and have a lot of fun up in Sacramento. Also get to learn that Hastings is a law school that the state runs. I didn't know that before, so I've never really been focused on education, so that's been a real good learning experience. And because the state can't seem to completely finish its budget on time, it requires special sessions, and one of the two, one is transportation, the other is health. I'm on the health special session committee, which means that we have to decide whether or not we increase the tax on managed care organizations. The governor wants about $1.7 billion in more taxes. And so we are having fun with that. So with that, I put together an incredible group of staff members. After I was elected, I was bombarded. I had more than 50 wonderful resumes. And so it was just a real treat to staff Sacramento and staff the district office. In fact, the individuals I got up in Sacramento, they're just such strong horses that I've already lost one, because when you have so many strong people, she just got recruited away by an assembly member. She's going to run his Sacramento office. So it's a promotion. I can't make a counter, but I will have, like I did at the supervisor's office, I hired great people. They all got, a lot of them got hired away, better jobs, better pay. And so you can't counter, but you got great alumni all over the place. So we want to focus. There's so much. This state is so massive. But we want to really focus on some specific subjects while I'm up there. So evaluating the state's fiscal health, I'll get into that in a second. We wanted to focus on fixing California's finances and governance. And we wanted to provide transparency and accountability, something I tried to do when I was supervisor at the county. So the goal, and if I'm blocking, am I blocking, Bonnie, you want me to go slower if you're writing notes? Okay. our goal was just to have a business-friendly, solvent and prosperous state in which families can thrive. I'm amazed almost every time I get out, someone comes up really close to me and says, we're thinking about moving to Texas. Or, you know, fill in the blank. You know, we've just kind of had it up to here and we're ready to go. And so what can we do to make this state a little more livable? So the state is required to only pass one bill every year, the legislature, just one bill, and that's the budget bill. So we are focused on that. So I want to give you a little just a quick background on our fiscal health. The budget for 2015-16 that we approved is $256 billion, almost $250 billion. So thank you for your contributions. As a representative from the state, I want to at least share our appreciation. But last year, the budget was $254 billion. So we have approved the largest budget in state history. Our general fund grew by $7 billion, and it's been going like a rocket ship. You know, is this sustainable? Are we always thinking that tomorrow is going to be better than yesterday when we don't have much of an inflation on the horizon? So here's what the budgets have been for the last couple decades. And you can see that by the black line, that's what the growth should be based on increase in population and inflation. So we are well beyond where we should have been. And didn't we have a great recession recently? I mean, it's just,
the last 10 years,
yeah, didn't we? You wouldn't, you, well, that's because what you do is you tap into all your reserves and you wipe out everything you've got in cash and you start borrowing from people. And that's what the state has done to balance their spending plan. So the governor had a budget that he wanted, and my colleagues on the other side of the aisle had a bigger budget that they wanted. They really threw in all kinds of fun stuff. And so on the floor of the Senate, we're not allowed to use props. We don't do PowerPoints. We don't do, you know, you can't bring in graphs or anything. So I went up and I said, colleagues, I don't agree with your budget. We already got a record budget by Governor Brown, and you want to go way beyond that. And so I said, I've got a gift for the governor. I reach into my pocket, you know, my coat, and I pull out blue pencils. you know, you're not supposed to have props. So it's just kind of fun. And I said, I've got a gift for the governor. Someone caught that and photographed me. But the president of the Senate came up to me, Kevin DeLeon, and he said, that was a great idea. And then he called me a name or two and then sat back at his desk. So with all this wonderful budget news, extra cash, blah, 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 our state is still in extremely poor fiscal health. We have the highest unfunded pension obligations, minimum $140 billion with CalPERS, CalSTRS, and the UC systems. We have the highest unfunded retiree medical at $72 billion. We haven't started funding that until just the last few days. We have the nation's highest deferred infrastructure maintenance of at least $59 billion. You pay the highest road taxes, you get the worst roads. How's that for a sad statistic? Now, I told you about the county's unrestricted net deficit of being $30 million when I became a supervisor in 06. The state's unrestricted net deficit is $117 billion. If I showed you the balance sheet of the state, we just barely have more assets than liabilities. Just barely. We were actually... It was reversed for a long time. We actually had more in debt than we had in assets. We are in such poor shape. Duff said he was from Chicago, and he said, you know, he mentioned Illinois by accident, but Illinois is a mess. They've already told their lottery winners they can't pay on time with the cash flow problems. Just to show you, at this number of $117 billion was at the end of our last fiscal year, 2014. It takes our auditors a good 9 months to get the financial statements done and audited. So I don't expect the states until about mid-March, but we have new Government Accounting Standard Board pronouncements, GASB 68, 69, that now require governments to put their unfunded liabilities on the balance sheet, something that the SEC and everyone else, private, you know, publicly traded corporations have been doing for almost over decades. Now government has to. So I expect when that financial statement comes out that our unrestricted net deficit, our owner's equity, will be a negative $250 billion. You're going to start seeing all kinds of incredible news articles as reporters figure this thing out. So where do we rank? We have to thank New Jersey that we're not in last place. So what I did is you take your unrestricted net deficit and you divide it by the population to get a per capita. So let's, you know, how do we compare? Because we're the largest state, so we're going to be the largest everything. So what is it per capita? And so Governor Christie has, you know, the joy of running the bluest, deepest, craziest state in the union. In 49th, we have Connecticut. In 48th, we have Illinois. My wife and I just drove through Illinois 2 months ago. My grandkids live in Milwaukee. My brother moved to Memphis. And so I thought, I just want to see Illinois because it's keeping us out of last place. And except for Chicago, it's just farmland. And farmers, their revenue's down this year. I just see waitresses. I see gas station attendants. I don't know how you tax these people anymore. I just don't get what they're thinking in Illinois. But Illinois is great because every other governor goes to prison. I mean, it's just, you know, you can't make this stuff up. Then we have Massachusetts, and then we finally show up in 46th place. So if by the end of my tenure, if I could move California up a few slots, I would feel real successful. So with that, there's Kentucky and New York. So here's the slide that kind of shows you for like the last 7 years where the priorities for the state have been. Where were we 7 years ago? What's changed? And what's really amazing is that the area that has changed the least is transportation. Our governors have not focused on transportation. We've actually been at about $10 billion for the last 12 years. And so I find it really fascinating that they would come and tell you that the roads are bad because you're not paying enough in taxes. But I don't see an emphasis on roads. In fact, so I do a little digging, and here just for the last six years, this is where Caltrans has been. No big commitment by the state to work on our roads. But this is our gas tax. They tell you it's leveled out because we're driving more fuel-efficient cars and everybody now has a Tesla, or at least every other one of us does. And but yet our gas taxes have been going up every year. So let's say 7.8 to now 9.4. So there's $2.5 billion. Now where's it gone? The state has even reduced its skin in the game with our gas taxes. Bill, you should be really upset. Yeah. I mean, Bill, you more carpool lanes maybe with that. But it's like, where has it gone? It's gone into the pension system. I mean, they've just shifted it all the way over. And I'll answer your question at the end. In the meantime, I get to heckle you, not the other way around. So we pay, then budget priorities. Orange County is at the short end of the stick. When Prop 13 passed, we were the most efficient run county in the state. We get 6.5 cents for every dollar we collect in property tax. San Francisco gets 65 cents. So we are at the bottom, they're at the top. So we got to fix that. The vehicle license fee adjustment, had a lot of fun in my last couple years as supervisor fighting the state on that. AB 109 is the public safety realignment. The governor had to reduce prison population, so he gave the inmates to us. So if you want to know why your personal property crime is up. And then we've got to work on healthcare realignment as well with the Obamacare. Someone's already asked about that. So how do we dig out? And the answer I get from the other side is we raise tax rates, right? That's what we get all the time. We could just raise the managed care organization tax, we raise the car tax, we raise the gasoline per gallon tax. So we already have the highest income tax, we have the highest sales tax, and if you throw in cap and trade, we have the highest gas tax. Seriously, we're going to raise rates? I mean, what are those guys thinking? But I will tell you this, for all the faults that California has, the weather here is just great. That's what you're paying for, right? So managing the budget priorities, we want to shoot some proposals and have some fun with legislation. The state budget is chopped into two components, 40% education, 60% everything else. And I'll talk about that a little bit. I want to talk about pension reforms. I want to talk about transparency reforms. I want to talk about regulatory reforms, Caltrans reforms, and then mental health emergency reforms. So 40% of the budget in 1988, we had Prop 98, and it said we have to use 40% of revenues collected for education. But what's been really cool about the CTA, the California Teachers Association, all these powerful teachers unions, is that they've been able to get a little more spending into the 60%. So I'm on the floor of the Senate, and they want us to approve a bond issue for schools to build more buildings. And I stand up and I said, do you realize that if we approve this bond, it will be paid out of the 60%, not out of the school side. And do you realize that we just approved the biggest budget, and that budget has expanded the 40%, and that expanded 40% will be the new floor next year. So you're gonna have this number coming back at you, and then you're gonna see out of the 60% pension costs go up, you're gonna see all these other, health care go up. And so it's going to squeeze out all the programs you want to do, but now you want to pay for those bonds out of the 60%, which will squeeze you guys even all the more. We were able to stop that bond measure. They couldn't get the 2/3, but they got the signatures. So you'll see it on the November 2016 ballot. So that's what we call a 98 spillover. We're spending $83 billion a year now on K through 12, about $14,000 per student. Wow. Don't even get me started on the average scores. And then we want to say, hey, why are we paying bond payments for schools outside of Prop 98, and why are we paying for their pension contributions outside of Prop 98? So we're going to have some fun so that this 40-60 doesn't go to 50-50, and that's something that even the liberal Democrats would understand. So we'll have some fun with that. Then we want to attack unfunded liabilities. I've already told you about the numbers at these, but even cartoonists are getting it. These retirement benefits, Vallejo may go file Chapter 9 again. We've had Stockton, we've since had City of San Bernardino, and these, we've had Detroit. Pretty much the pension plans put them into Chapter 9. And Judge Rhodes, the federal judge there, did reduce pension benefits for retirees. This came out last week. The state auditor came out with a report on high-risk local governments. Thank goodness not one of these cities is in Orange County, but at least the state auditor is starting to look at who's next? You know, we might as well get in front of these things. So pension reform, we just want to provide a defined benefit contribution option. This will be killed. The unions hate defined contribution plans. So we have will be killed. And I use that after someone that ran for city council, Ron, you might remember, I invited him to a city council debate at the Rotary Club when I was program chair. And it had to be 92, the 92 election cycle. And he showed up in an orange dress and high heels. Do you remember who it was? Do you remember?
I'm trying to think who that'd be.
It was Will B. King. Oh, well. Remember Will B. King? Remember Will B. King?
Yeah.
So I just think it's so funny. So I had this category. We were looking at what kind of bills we could do, and I came up with Will B. Killed. You know, these Democrats will kill this bill, but we got to do it anyway. We've got to get out there and say, we've got to fix this. They got to figure it out. But we know they're going to kill it because the unions would just go ballistic on defined contribution plans. We just want them to play fair and have the same rules as the private sector. And we want to allow for voter approval. This is something we did in 2008. I did Measure G. And any time the Board of Supervisors of this county negotiates a pension improvement for the employees and it creates an immediate unfunded liability, then you've got to approve it. It's got to go on the ballot. So you can go ahead and do whatever you want, but it won't be effective until you approve it. So we put a nice valve on future improvements. And this was in the charter of a very conservative county that I stole it from. It was San Francisco County. It passed 70% of the vote, and it was fun. Last year, we put in an idea that Steve Menzinger, our current city mayor, came up with, COIN, a civic openness in negotiations. You know, it's really hard to explain what negotiations are like because I can't tell you anything in closed session. Sorry, am I touching my microphone? And so, you know, we've got a budget problem, and so I need to keep salaries level. Maybe even in a lot of counties, they had to reduce salaries. But the unions come in and say, we need, you know, 20% increases, right? And we need more holidays. And I'm thinking, you need less holidays. You got Columbus, you got, you know, Martin Luther, you got all these that no one else has. And so you kind of come in and they're hoping maybe halfway, right? But they come in with some crazy, crazy proposals. And so how do you stop that nonsense? Well, if you had to make their proposals public, then we'd all say, we'd all have a good laugh together looking, really? That's what they really want? How funny is that? So we want to try and do that. We got beat up this year. After I implemented COIN at the county level, I got the union so mad that they found Senator Tony Mendoza, who's got a little bit of Orange County, he's out of Artesia, but he did a bill, Senate Bill 331, that says if you adopted COIN, then you have to have these onerous restrictions on every other contract that you go out and try to get. It was like a poison pill. It was nasty, and it barely passed the legislature, and then the governor just signed it, and so it was just a real shame. But we want to come back in their faces and say, hey, we still think that every proposal, counterproposal, and supposal made during labor negotiations should be made public. It should be negotiated by someone independent, not someone who works for the municipality, because they want the raise too. They're not independent. They are conflicted. Get someone neutral outside. And then have someone give an analysis. Find out what it is going to really cost. And I can give you war stories there on how so many cities and counties voted for pension benefits because they were told it wasn't going to cost anything without really doing any kind of fiscal analysis. And so we're going to see what we can do in that form. But regulatory reform, regulations should be constitutional. They should be explicitly authorized and controlled by statute. They should not create new law. They should consider the separation of power. And we just need to do a reality check. Individual agencies, departments are less likely to scrutinize their regulations objectively. And we need to put those regulations out for the legislature to approve. Now, can you say AQMD? I mean, try, you know, fire pits and all the rigmarole we had the last 2 years. So we've come up with, we stole this acronym from a bill in Congress, Regulations from the Executive in Need of Scrutiny. We're going to call it the RAINS Act. And we're going to say, look, if you're going to do a regulation, you know, have all the fun you want, but we get to vote on it. as legislators. And I think this will be something that my colleagues on the other side of the aisle might like, because they like power, right? They like control. And so we say, hey, why don't you guys own these regulations instead of letting some faceless bureaucrats do it? And we should verify that they don't negatively impact on the state's economy. Ha ha, I think they all impact the state economy, but we've got to start cutting things. So Caltrans reform, I could not submit legislation this year because I was elected after the due date. But because we have special session, you can bring legislation in all you want, any time, no deadline. So for the transportation special session, I decided to take a bill that would require Caltrans to outsource a little bit more of their work. Now, OCTA outsources about 50% of their architect and engineering work. Most of the states we researched, they're about 50%. Some are stars. Florida's 80%, Arizona's 85%. The state of California outsources 10% raw, you know. And Arnold Schwarzenegger tried to pass a bill 6 or 7, 8 years ago that was going to increase the amount of outsourcing for Caltrans from 10% to 11%. Wow. We're talking that. We call that moving the dial. And that bill failed. So I walk in to special session of transportation. I said, I want to increase the amount of outsourcing from 10% to 15% in 1 year. And then in the second year, I want to go to 20%. And by the eighth year, we'll be at 50-50, just like everyone else. Management didn't show up to oppose my bill. The union did. And this guy was slick, and he was giving statistics that were incorrect. And I was getting kind of pilloried by my colleagues. Those that were union reps in their first jobs, you know, said, I'm sorry, I philosophically have to disagree with you. I made the mistake of saying, I'm shocked, you know, when the microphone was on. But, you know, I got kind of picked on by one respected senator, and he thought I was just poking Caltrans with a stick in the eye, right? And I said, well, Senator, you don't give me the opportunity to do PowerPoints, and you don't give me the chance to really give you data. I just get to come up here, say a few words about how important this is. But let me tell you this. I ran a department. I was responsible for $7 billion. And I ran a county. I was responsible for a budget, $5.5 billion. My county is bigger than 20 states in population. I've really run a state. And if I got an audit report, or even two audit reports, or three audit reports like Caltrans has had, heads would roll. And you don't need to tell me how to run a department. You don't need to tell me, this department sucks. I mean, I didn't say it that way, but I said, this department needs some serious help. And if we convert them to 15%, it won't hurt them at all, because they have, one, too many employees, and two, 54% of them are already retirement age. They will attrition out. We won't lay off one person. This is like a no-brainer. Well, it'll cost us more. No, it will not, because once the economy goes down again, we got to make layoffs, and you're not making layoffs. But we can terminate contracts with outside firms. So in May of 2014, the Legislative Analyst Office, which is embedded in the state government, came out with a report and said that Caltrans had too many employees. Not 35 too many, not 350 too many, they had 3,500 too many. And this report languishes. No one does anything. There's no CEO at Sacramento. No one says, hey, let's get in here and fix this place. So with 3,500 too many, 54% ready to retire, but you multiply 3,500 by an average compensation package of 143. This is salary, medical, pension. We're talking that you're paying $500 million a year for nothing. Nada. And no one does anything. And Sacramento's like, you know, I'm sorry. So I get interrupted by my staff, and they said, "Hey, Channel 7, Channel 10 is here. They want to interview you." "Well, why?" He says, "Well, you're the expert now in Caltrans, and the state auditor just came out with another report." I said, "What does it say?" "It says that one of their employees, in quotes, will golf as many days as he can." So you look at the report, and over an 18-month period, this guy golfed 55 days on state time. 55 days. Testing. And it was funny. It's like the movie Office Space. You know, like we had two supervisors, right? They approved his time reports, but it was like you were watching him, right? No. I thought you were watching him, right? It was just, what was really funny is that report came out on a Friday, and so the camera's in my face. "Senator Moorlach, what do you think about the fact that Caltrans has someone golfing 55 days? And I said, "Well, they are overstaffed by 3,500 employees. What else is there to do?" And it just went viral. It was just unbelievable. It costs Caltrans three times the national average to repair a mile of road. I mean, Michigan has snow on the ground right now. I just wanted you to know, but we can't compete with other states. We pay that much more, three times, not 1.1 times the national average, three times plus the national average. And have you seen the Bay Bridge? $6.4 billion to repair a bridge. You know, you could have done a tunnel under the bay cheaper than that and gotten more traffic through. And in the Bay Bridge is already deemed a problem child because it's already got water leaks and all kinds of other fun stuff. You just read the articles up north. So we need to reform Caltrans. It turned out that this audit report came out on a Friday, and then we found out that on Thursday, and then on Friday we found out that the head of Caltrans, Malcolm Dougherty, was going to be in Dove Canyon here in Orange County, and he was going to participate in a golf tournament. And we just thought, how tone deaf is this boy? So we do a press release, you know, saying, you know, why don't you do it on a weekend, you know, or something else? What kind of example are you setting? And they went ballistic. They did two things. One, they called my office and wanted me to retract the press release because Malcolm Dougherty was doing it on a vacation day. And how dare I impugn him and the nonprofit and the fundraising event? And they wanted me to retract the press release. They were just indignant. And we said, well, why don't you show us his time reports for the last 2 years, because he goes to this tournament every year, and if he showed it as vacation time the last 2 years, we'll gladly retract our press release. They never called back. Then they tweeted, Moorlach gets a per diem. Why doesn't he donate 2 days of his per diem to the tournament, to the nonprofit? And that went down pretty fast, but my staff was able to print it. Now, every elected official that doesn't live in Sacramento gets a per diem because we have to live somewhere. We got to live in a hotel when we're up there, and they just pay for our hotel room, so it's a wash, you know. But I thought it was interesting that he went after an elected official. Now, I'm 20 years elected, and I will not be disrespected by a state employee or a county employee. I don't care what. We may have a disagreement, but you're not going to use state time to go after me. That is not going to happen. So I went to Kevin DeLeon, our president pro tem, and I said, Kevin, I'm assuming you get a per diem because you're from L.A. He said, yeah. I said, well, then this staff member, the PIO for Caltrans, went after all of us. So I'll tell you what. Here's a copy of what they did. I'm going to let you take care of it. I'm not going to say anything. I'm going to be polite. I'm going to be calm, but you take care of it. If it happens again, don't worry about a thing. I'll take care of it. So State auditor. I mean, these are state auditor boards. These are not like think tanks or gadflies. These are like state employees. They come out in 2011 said that Caltrans was over budget on 62% of their projects. And when you get the Caltrans reports, they send them to all of us. Hey, we're doing really great, all color, glossy reports. We completed 98% of our projects. Thanks for all the paper. So we got a lot of work to do with Caltrans. The other day, there were two Caltrans employees side by side working all day. And at the end of the day, one of them just gets mad and he smashes a snail. And the other one says, "What in the world? What's that all about? That snail did nothing to you." And the guy says, "Are you kidding? He's been following me all day long." I mean, and you can make jokes like that till the cows come home, but we don't need to raise our taxes. Just fix a bureaucracy that's run by unions that has, you know, half a billion a year, too much in expense. I can't come to you and say we need to raise our taxes. I'm sorry. This is crazy. And with a two-thirds requirement, we stopped them. We stopped the legislature this year. We probably prevented them from raising our taxes by $29 billion. So it was a fun year. I also want to do mental health and some transfer from what's called Prop 63. This is for most of you in the room. This is for everyone that earns $1 million or more in taxable income. And we want to shift a little bit of that money and put it into emergency rooms in the county. We have no beds for mentally ill people. When they come into the emergency room, they're taking up your spot. And they don't stay for an hour. They stay for like 24 hours. And we've got to figure out how to do that. And if I can transfer some money from Prop 13, we can get that done. This is the list of my staff members in the Sacramento office and in the office here in Costa Mesa. I moved the office to Costa Mesa. I live in Costa Mesa. I inherited an office in Irvine, but it was so inefficient, and we would look really hard. And so we're in the same building that Tom Harmon, I think, used to be in when he was state senator. So I'm really glad to be back in my hometown. So to close, these are the observations I've been getting. You know, I'm in Sacramento. Fly up Monday, come back Thursday. And there's a lot of people that they make their living in Sacramento, lobbyists and others. And so one of the first things that they keep saying to me is, "You actually read the bills." You know, it's like, I don't have to. I mean, it's the second is you ask great questions. We're actually watching committee meetings more now because you're there. No one asked questions before. You're taking on Bob Hertzberg and you're going toe to toe. We're having a ball. And they'll start telling me things, questions I asked, and repeat things. I'm going, boy, I almost forgot about that. I had one city council member in my district. She said, "I want to know how you do that. You ask them the meanest questions and you smile the whole way through and you're really polite." So I had one quick story. Senator Hill from San Mateo had a tragedy in his district. He had the San Bruno gas line rupture that killed 20 people. It was tragic. So he negotiated a penalty for PG&E, $1.7 billion. Part of it for new pipes, part of it for ratepayer rebates, part of it pure penalty. And when that was all done, then he came back with a bill and he wanted to make it completely non-deductible, retroactive, sort of like, you know, they make a deal and now all of a sudden they can't deduct it. And so it was a tax bill, required two-thirds vote. So I'm in committee. And I said, "Senator, do utilities get to deduct the dividends they pay out?" He said, "No, they don't." I said, so a utility company is just like any other corporation. We get to tax them at their rates, at their level, and then we get to tax the shareholders when they get their dividends. It's double taxation. It's sort of an interesting concept. He said, "Yeah." I said, "Well, do you think PG&E is going to give a dividend if they can't deduct $1.7 billion? I don't know. I said, "Well, have you modeled it? Which works out better, double taxation or no dividend? Have you modeled that?" No, I haven't. "Oh, so how many older people do you have in your district? Because a lot of older clients that I had in my client base, they kind of like to buy utility stocks because it had a regular dividend. How many of them are they going to be a little put out that they're not getting a dividend because of your bill?" "Oh, I don't know." And then all of a sudden, everybody else is starting to pick it up. You know, they're getting it. Like, oh, geez, if they don't get dividends, then CalPERS won't get dividends. And all of a sudden, we were able to stop Senator Hill's bill. And man, was he furious. And when he got on the floor, he knew he wasn't going to get the votes. And so he'd talk about his bill and how important it was, and then he would stop. And then he started giving us the biographies of the people that were killed, you know, a few at a time. I mean, he was really, he was shooting with all pistons running. But we showed the governor that we can stop a two-thirds bill. And by the end of the session, the governor was like ballistic. I mean, his press conferences were like, well, if I can't do it through legislation, I'll have it done through the regime. You know, like, with the regime? Jerry, calm down. You've hired an amazing staff. You look like you're having fun. I am having fun. I know I'm in a blue state. I'm not worked up about it. I'm just going to have fun. I'm just going to embarrass them when I can and just ask questions that they've got to try and answer. And I can tell you stories all night long. And you're getting along with those on the other side of the aisle. We thought you'd be this big butt from Orange County, is what I was told. But you've done this, you've done that, you've done this. You get, you know, you make your speeches brief. The Democrats have told me they enjoy working with me, which is kind of fun. In fact, I communicate. If you get my emails, I'm getting a lot of good feedback from people saying, boy, we're getting more detail out of you than anyone. And you tell us how you vote and why, and we really appreciate it. And I do it for feedback. I get good ideas back. But at the end of the session, we're like the last week, and this is Assemblyman Nazarian. And I got to know him earlier in the year. I went to the Armenian caucus reception because this year is the centennial of the genocide of Armenians in Turkey. And so I was the only one to vote for his bill. He had a simple bill. I'm older now. I get blood tests every 6 months. I've been amazed with how much my doctor tells me about myself just from my blood test and how I'm doing with my carbohydrates and everything else. I'm just going, really? You know, yeah, you're losing weight. You're doing, okay, great. I do a lot of walking in Sacramento. And he had a bill that said, hey, if you're in the clinic, you can check a box that they would, while they're doing the blood test, they would check for AIDS. And I kind of thought, well, that makes a whole lot of sense. So why would I be opposed to that? So I voted for it. And so Assemblyman Nazarian, he comes by. It's like a five-second exchange. It's like this bro-man thing. You know, he's like, hey, John, how you doing? And thanks. And thank y'all, you're welcome. And then off he goes. But Cal Matters, their photographer, caught it. And so this photo in their article was in the Register, was in the San Jose Mercury News, was in the San Francisco Chronicle. It was all over the state, just this, hey, they're working together. These Republicans are working with the Democrats. And I thought that was a nice testimony after the end of the session to say, hey, you know, we can disagree agreeably. I still love them, but I still vote no on their bills. And so the first time I voted no on Kevin DeLeon's bill, one of his bills, I was really scared. I was like, I went up to him and I said, which committees am I going to lose now? Because I voted against the president's pro tem's bills. And so that's my presentation. Thank you, Tom, for giving me a little extended time. I'll take questions until, what, midnight? I'll start.
Well, I got two questions. It doesn't go that long.
Don, you wanted the microphone to travel around?
And, no.
It's the videotaping they're doing. We want to make sure.
Okay.
Otherwise, I can repeat the questions. Make it a five-word question, please.
I did not know that they won't let you use PowerPoint up there. And so how can you get these points across and show them graphs and what's going on?
You just have to...
You have to have it all in your head?
Or you go, this is down.
Yeah?
Can you change the rules?
Well, okay.
So you have to actually go through rules committee to say, hey, we're going to put in an easel, we're going to put on graphs. Or you do that at a press conference, but not at the floor. So there's a lot of decorum rules, like I cannot refer to another senator by name. I have to say the senator from San Bruno or from L.A. or from Agoura Hills or whatever. And so, you know, there's just all these interesting little issues that I have to learn all the formalities. It's a very, you know.
That must be tough because I have trouble when I have to learn a whole new routine just to try to get my point across.
Yeah, or you try to get in front of everyone individually, which is a real killer to try and meet with the other 39 to make your case or give them your information. And what's really even more difficult is that when I was supervisor, you would get the agenda on Wednesday morning and you'd vote on Tuesday. So you'd have all this time to have your staff review every agenda item, decide how we were going to vote, and I'd read everything that they're briefing on the weekend, and on Monday we'd ask open-ended, you know, questions that were still lingering, and if we still didn't get it done, we'd ask those questions at the board meeting on Tuesday morning. Here, I sometimes get the agenda the night before. I'm reading in my hotel room till way past midnight to get prepared for the next day, and I don't have time to ask these guys questions. So you have to raise your mic, get recognized, and then you have to ask permission to ask the author questions about the author's bill. So I raised my microphone one morning and I said to the senator from San Bruno, Senator, your bill requires that security guards get a mental test every 6 months. Now, I'm a CPA and I had to turn in my continuing professional education every 2 years, and that was kind of a big chore. So how do you expect these guys every 6 months to do this test? And he's looking at me and he's quiet, and I'm looking at him and he's looking at me, and I'm realizing that this senator didn't even know it was in the bill. And he's looking at me like deer in the headlights, and he's thinking, I'm watching him think, and I did not want to do a gotcha. I just wanted to know why. And I'm watching him, and he finally says, well, there must be a good professional reason for requiring that this mental check be done every 6 months. And I thought, I can't bag this guy. I gotta back off. But I've had that a couple times where you ask questions. I got in trouble with one of my Republican colleagues because she was asked a simple question by Senator Hertzberg when the assembly came with their bills to the Senate. And she had two staff members, one on each side, and they're whispering in her ears, trying to help her get the answer. And it's like this silence, you know, and it just keeps going and going. And I'm like, I got things to do. I mean, I don't get any sleep up here. I feel like I'm in college when I'm in Sacramento. And I should have turned the mic off. I don't know why. I start humming. Do 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 do. This lady gives me the stares she gave me. She hasn't talked to me since. She won't. This was, she's a nice Republican, but she won't talk to me. So I'm new. I'm learning.
Well, it sounds like good training for the federal, where I hope you'll head one day. My second question, though, is I would think, I'm surprised to see you're on any committees. I would think they would be very fearful of you up there with all you've done and how you really look at things carefully. I would think all these guys that have been in power for a while would say, well, let's not have the senator on our committee.
Well, I can guarantee you they did not put me on the committees I wanted.
Okay.
They didn't put me on pensions. And a couple of others that I thought would be in my bailiwick. So yeah, we'll see. We just keep reminding everybody that it would be fun to be on certain committees, and we'll just see what happens. But I'm grateful for what I have, and it's been a real hoot.
All right, thank you very much.
You know, thank you.
I believe that CalPERS has an internal investment advisory board from members of CalPERS, and so can that be changed so that the state treasurer is in charge of their investments? Because the way it is now, that CalPERS, they always vote for politically correct investments.
So you're correct. It's a governing board. It's not internal, it's their governing board. Two-thirds of the members are either union members or union related. It's stacked. But I would never want the state treasurer to be in charge of CalPERS. And I'll give you a little story. In the late 90s, Tom Flanagan was the chief investment officer of CalSTRS. He was recruited away from New York and by Jesse Unruh. And so he was running CalSTRS, and his directive was get us fully funded. We're woefully underfunded. So In the late 90s, 98, 99, the stock market was just going gangbusters. Remember those days when we were making 20, 30% a year? And so the smart money said, why don't we sell our stocks because they're trading at 65 times earnings per share. This is unprecedented. We got companies making money that don't even have sales, right? But they didn't do that. They actually were watching CalPERS, and CalPERS was 60% invested in stock markets. So their annual returns were just going crazy. So the state controller, Kathleen O'Connell, I don't know if you remember her at all, and the state treasurer, Phil Angelides, they went to Tom Flanagan and they said, we want you to liquidate your fixed income portfolio. We want you to sell your 8% bonds and we want you to buy stocks at the top of the market. And Tom Flanagan kind of looked at him and said, are you guys crazy? Well, yeah, they were crazy. They were crazy. They wanted to run for governor. That's how crazy they were. And so if you could liquidate the bond portfolio, buy equities, stocks, you could hire all these money managers, you could roll U-Haul trucks on Wall Street and fill it up with contributions from all these money managers to run your gubernatorial campaign. You were already touched on it, and you said, hey, you know, we got to get the politics out of it, but if you have an elected official in charge of the pension system, what a mess. I had a lot of fun this year. We had one bill, it was actually written by Kevin DeLeon, the president pro tem, and he wanted, his bill was to direct the pension systems to liquidate all of their investments in coal. You know, this greenhouse thing, climate control is like spills over, you know, everywhere. We're going to save the world, California is. That's just ask Jerry. You know, if you can't fix California, fly to France. So I got up and I said, you don't tell investment managers how to invest. You tell them to invest for value and just leave them alone. And if they're not getting you value, then make some adjustments. But you don't tell them how to divest or invest. So that bill passed, of course. And fortunately, the CalPERS only has about $85 million in coal. So it's not like, it's like a pimple compared to the $400 billion we should have. So, but $400 billion, excuse me. So it's just really interesting. Just we gotta let managers manage. And let the politicians and the elected stay out, but we definitely have to change the structure of the CalPERS board, because anyone that dares say defined contribution plan, they'll never get on that board. The governor won't approve it. They won't allow that person to come on. And I can give you more war stories on that as well. But CalPERS doesn't realize it's in the pension business. They just think they're in the defined benefit pension business. And we've got a long ways to go to fix them. They're sort of realizing it. They're trying to reduce their interest rate assumption on what they can earn from 7.5 down to a lower number, but they're not doing it immediately. They're doing it over 19 years. And even Governor Brown and I agree that that's crazy. It should be done a lot quicker. And so Jerry and I have agreed on a lot of things this year, and that's one of them, but we've got lots to do. And I'm sorry for a really long answer to you.
My question is about transportation. Is there any way that you can see that we can separate the road money from the transit money, from the mass transit and so on? Right now they bundle them together. I was going to ask, but I expect that slide that you showed was the combination of, it was all transportation money, including both roads and mass transit. Mass transit doesn't do much good. Those high-speed rails aren't really going to do much.
Let me attack that in two different ways. The first is, you know, I had a lot of experience with just local transportation with OCTA and Measure M and how much money they've allocated to mass transit. So after all these years, you and I have been working on this for, what, 25 years? After all these years, only less than 2% of the population uses the train.
Yep.
But everything we're doing is focused on getting them to that train.
Can you fix it?
Can you fix it? It's just baffling that the pro transit people, you know, even the buses, you read the register, the buses aren't being utilized. I mean, they can't figure out what business they're in and what they should modify, because if they cut their main line in Santa Ana where all the passengers are, then they got to cut something in South County where no passengers are. I mean, it's just, these guys can't, they can't figure it out because they don't want to upset certain electeds. Well, screw that. Run a business, you know, and you put all your buses in Harbor Boulevard and get, you know, the low-income people in downtown Santa Ana where they need to go. No, they got to build a trolley system, right? And got to put it in Santa Ana, and then they got to put one in Anaheim. I think we killed Anaheim, but me and Tom Tate were the only no votes. I mean, it's just, it's like free money from the federal government, right? But on the other side, high-speed rail, that's a great idea. Sorry to wake you up, Joan.
You drive to Hemet to get a train to San Francisco and you can be there half the time.
If you go on the internet to get a ticket to take the train to San Francisco, you'll get on for Santa Ana, Fullerton, wherever you want, and they will take you to L.A., and then they will take you off, put you on a bus, and you'll drive over the grapevine to Bakersfield. You get back on a train, and then you go to Stockton. You'll get back off. I mean, there we have no pent-up demand for taking a train to San Francisco. You know, getting through the San Gabriels and the Tehachapis, I mean, this is like engineering, you know, this is like tunneling, you know, magnified. This is going to be unbelievable. So, you know, we're not talking $68 billion. We're talking a whole lot more money. And by the time they finish this rail, this high-speed rail, you know the day it opens, Southwest Airlines reduces their plane ticket prices and everybody gets on a plane. So you want to go, you want to go for an hour and a half or you want to go for 6 hours because they're going to stop everywhere. I've never seen a bigger boondoggle, and I've got a governor that just will not let go. He will not let go of high-speed rail. He sees federal money coming in. He sees jobs for union members. He sees legacy. And he just will not let go. You saw yesterday in the LA Times, Lopez, Assemblywoman Lopez, finally said, so she broke from the Democrats. They're all huddled together, too. And she says, this doesn't make sense. I'm out. So maybe, you know, one at a time, we can start getting enough. And we can get to 20 in the Senate or 21 and 41 in the Assembly. Maybe we have a chance to stop this stupid thing. But, I remember I got up for a bill. It was just to hire two more appraisers to buy more land, to eminent domain. And I got up and I said, every time I speak in my district and I say high-speed rail, the whole crowd moans. So I am voting no on every bill that relates to high-speed rail. Just get ready for it, because that's all I'm going to say. And sat down.
John, we got time for one more question. Here you go.
Could you tell me over the last, let's say, 5 years or so, how many companies have left California, to be followed by another question, by the way?
We have a gentleman here in Irvine. All of a sudden his first name escapes me, but it's Vranick. And Joel Kotkin just quoted his study. It just came out last month. It was about Veterans Day. It came out. And he determined, he's a specialist, helps companies relocate. And he calculated that over the last 5 years, like 9,000 businesses have left California. So I think right now, Texas out-exports us as a manufacturing state. But I'm getting the sense that our biggest export pretty soon is going to be people.
Yes. Well, one of the reasons why I asked that is because, you know, we fight the budget all the time. Like you said, it went up again this year. And do we have anybody in the state that's responsible for, like we do with movies, to attract them to stay here? I mean, it seems to me like that should be a significant issue.
The governor's office has a division called GoBiz, which tries to work with businesses to give them credits. So you have to give your business plan and how many people you're going to hire, and if you meet those goals, they will give you X amount of tax credits. So you have to somehow divulge and make public your business plan and your growth plan. And I marvel at how crazy it all is. But at least the Democrats can say we're doing something. But talk about control freakish, bizarre, So that's what they have. This year, I just purposed to vote no on just about every tax credit because we're broke. We're technically broke. And how do you keep giving tax credits? You mentioned the movies. The state of Louisiana gave a credit to the movie studios. And Jindal, Governor Jindal, had to stop it because it was wiping out his budget. They did Jurassic Park there. They did all these movies. It was eating up their state budget. It wiped them out. It said, you know, I kind of believe in no better, no worse. You know, I'd rather give everybody a tax cut than just one business. You know, if the movie theater and the movie makers are having a tough time here, go somewhere else. I don't care. But, you know, why should we subsidize one particular industry, especially one that kind of contributes to Hillary Clinton and a few others? But I would think we've got to be fair. And I even voted against the earned income tax credit. All right, that's how big a butt I am from Orange County. But you have to earn less than $7,000 to get this rebate. So a guy who's making less than $7,000, what, he can afford a tax preparer? You know, by the time the preparer does the return for him, the rebate pays for the fee. I mean, it's just like, where does this all, and the, but it was supposed to get, cost the state $400 million. And I said, how do you do that on one hand and then ask the doctors and the medical groups to pay $1.7 billion when you're giving away $400 million? I said, who figures all this out? So sure enough, at the end of the session, Governor Brown vetoed almost all those credit bills, the ones that I voted against, and some that I actually voted for because they were going to take care of ADA lawsuits when people come in and say, I can't get my wheelchair in your business, and they sue your butt off. We're trying to fix that as well. But I tried to tell the author, tone down your credit. No, I got to keep this big credit. And I said, yeah, and then the governor vetoed it. So we're going to see if we can fix that. But I could talk. I had so much fun this year. I could talk and tell stories. We should do a campfire outside and just kind of. But I want to thank you for your encouragement, your support, and for your time and being patient with me to be able just to dump the whole load on you. So thank you, Tom. I really appreciate it.
We get a comment on the national scene, the presidential candidates, and that whole thing that's going on.
No. I sort of with you. I've met with Scott Walker, and he's a fine man. And my grandkids live in Wisconsin, so I've got a little bit of a bias. So I was a little disappointed when he pulled out. I still haven't made a selection.
I wasn't asking you for your choice. I was kind of just what you think of the fact that Trump is saying the things he is, and the fact that the three top candidates are non-politicians. Is that something that you see as just an anomaly, or is it a trend that's going to?
It's reality. People are pissed. No argument. People are really upset. You know, today's paper talked about the declining number of registered Republicans in Orange County, front page. And this trend has been going on. I could do a whole seminar on what's been happening in California and around the country. The Republican Party has failed to deliver a good product. So I am really glad that I had to run against the Republican establishment to get elected to this job. I'm not beholden to them. And I'm not worried about the Republican Party. I'm worried about California. It's going down the toilet. So what can I do to do the right thing fiscally so that our kids stay here and our grandkids stay here? Because this is the most impressive, incredible piece of real estate on the planet, right? And we love it here. But what can we do to fix it? And then if people say, hey, at least the Republicans are trying to fix it, at least then maybe we could start turning things around by saying, hey, we're just like you have on your stuff in the front foyer, yeah, we want people to succeed. We don't want to tax them to death. We want to lower their tax rates so they can be more productive, and then we raise revenues. So I'm not against raising taxes. I'm against raising tax rates. You know, Reagan lowered tax rates and our revenues just, you know, then the Democrats found more ways to spend it. But we got a governor that is sort of keeping the governor on his colleagues. But I go out there and people are upset. They're upset. And So I am not shocked that someone like Donald Trump would poll so high. It doesn't shock me at all.
Okay. Well, good. Let's give him another hand, okay?